you're an all-star. Get your game on, go play. Hey now, you're a rock star. Get the show on, get paid.
And all that glitters is gold.
Only shooting stars break the mold. It's a cool place.
Welcome along to this latest podcast. Rob Staton and Robbie Williams here to talk to you about the appointment of a new offensive coordinator in Seattle. Shane Waldron is the man who is going to replace Brian Schottenheimer, who's going to come over from the Rams. For me, Robbie, this was a surprise. You know, I woke up to the news this morning. A pleasant surprise, though, and I'll talk a little bit about why I think this is a good move a little bit later on. First of all, though, what was your instant reaction to the news?
Yeah, I mean, I was super excited. I mean, my first thought was like, they did it. They went and got someone that's a young play caller that, you know, that can be innovative and help Pete. And my worry was that it was going to be somebody like Kirby Wilson or someone like that, you know, had just come from Pete Carroll's coaching tree or somebody, you know, people are kind of like, you know, I've seen people kind of complaining, well, I mean, he doesn't really have any experience play calling. Well, I mean, do you want to go get a guy who has experience play calling that's got fired and isn't any good? No, I'd rather have someone who, you know, wants to have a chance to prove themselves. So I was really excited right out the gate when I saw that. I was fired up. I mean, this is something that I actually didn't expect. So I'm really happy with it.
I think it was a really important appointment, Robbie. And I think the main thing for me that I would take away from this, more so than, you know, the fact that he's from the McVay offense, which I think is a positive thing. I'm sure we'll talk about that. I think the most important thing is I can imagine, and I know I'm making an assumption here, and it doesn't automatically mean that this is going to work. That is also something I have to point out. But I can imagine that Russell Wilson will be okay with this. And we talked about how important that was. And, you know, people are already saying, oh, you know, it was all a big, you know, fuss over nothing. That there's absolutely no way. DK Metcalf is talking to Brandon Marshall and saying, we're too predictable, and just sitting there and saying, we've played this way since Pete came to Seattle. And you know, you've got Russell Wilson doing his press conference a week after Carroll and the things that he said and stressing how important this was. If they'd have just appointed Kirby Wilson, who was Carroll's coach in New England for 3 years, and then I think a receivers coach at USC, he's a running backs coach in Vegas now, hasn't had an interview for an offensive coordinator job in 7 years, hasn't ever called plays. If they make an appointment like that, then I think Russell Wilson's ringing Pete Carroll up and going, we've got a problem here, Pete, and we need to resolve this. And it could have ended up being a disaster. Now, I think they've avoided all of that. And I think that is the most important thing from this hire. It had to be somebody that Russell Wilson believed in. It didn't mean that Russell Wilson had to appoint the guy. It didn't mean that Russell Wilson had to have the final say, because that was never going to happen. It just had to be somebody that Russell Wilson can go, yeah, I get it. I understand why this makes sense. I can achieve what I want to achieve in this scheme, in this system, with this coach. And therefore, you've got a coach, a quarterback, and a coordinator all on the same page. That is what they had to achieve. Now, it remains to be seen whether Pete Carroll is sufficiently going to get out of the way here to allow Waldron to do exactly what he needs to do to make this offense sing. But I think that this is a positive sign. If he just wanted a yes man, which is what we were fearful of, he would have appointed Dave Canales. He would have appointed Nate Carroll. He would have appointed, you know, Kirby Wilson. And he hasn't done that. And I think the other positive thing from this, Robbie, we'll talk about McVay. We'll talk about schemes. We'll talk about the offense in LA in a little while. I think the most important thing, aside from what I've already talked about, is that it's exciting people. You've already said that you're very happy about it. I think there was a bit of apathy about the team. And people were starting to think, well, that was a crappy way for the last season to end. There's a bit of a weird off-season coming up here with not much money, a few picks. Things were looking a bit stale. Pete Carroll, people questioning him. For the first time, really, I would say that a lot of people were questioning Pete Carroll. And now people have been given an opportunity to feel a bit more positive about the team because of this hire.
Yeah, and I think it says a lot about Pete, right? Like, I mean, we were, you know, both of us had gone on here and we're questioning Pete's decision and you know, we were really wondering what he was going to do next when he let Brian Schottenheimer go or whatever, mutual pardon. And, you know, you start thinking about like, okay, what would he do if he would have went out and, you know, anointed one of these guys that just came from his tree? Then, you know, I think we would have all thought the same thing. Like, he's kind of lost his way, but maybe he's listening. Maybe he's understanding. Maybe he's, you know, we did see him change a little bit this year, you know, not only on the defensive side of the ball, but the offensive side of the ball. You know, originally it was let Russ cook, and there was a lot of positives about that. But when it stopped working is when he was like, okay, we go back to my way. So maybe he just understands that his way isn't always going to work, or maybe there's just a different way to run his and you know what he wants to do, because I mean, yeah, we'll talk about scheme, but I mean, you know, this guy has the ability to help get Russell out of the pocket, move him around a little bit, run those short to intermediate pass plays, you know, quick timing plays, you know, a scheme against someone instead of just going out there and be like, we're going to just be better than you and just this is how we're going to run it. Instead, they're going to actually scheme against people, and that's what you see out of McVay's offense. So I'm hoping that, you know, this is kind of what he'll bring to the table, and I'm really excited, and I think it does show growth on Pete's side as well. So I'm really excited about the hire. I think this is just a really good move for us, and it gives us something to be excited for.
Russell Wilson turns 33 this year, and although he often says that he wants to play till he's 45, it's not realistic. I mean, he may well do. I'm not writing it off, you know, just because Wilson says he's going to play till 45. The NFL might decide whether or not Russell Wilson is going to play till the age of 45, quite frankly. So he's 33 this year. If he plays for the same length of time as Philip Rivers, who's just retired, age 39, he may only have 6, 7, 8 more years in the league. When you actually put it like that, it's not that long. I mean, like, because when you sort of live through rookie Russell Wilson, which doesn't seem that long ago, and then you're sort of young Russell Wilson, and then you get Russell Wilson, then he's in the late 20s. And then you start talking about he may only have 6, 7, 8 seasons to go. All of a sudden, you kind of think, oh, wow, time has passed. And this is why it was such a critical hire, because he will have ambitions of what he wants to achieve in his career. And this is it. You know, statistically, where does he want to be in the list of all-time passers? Where does he want to be in terms of can he legitimately go for an MVP award? He will want to win some, you know, another Super Bowl. He'll at least want to be contending for Super Bowls, which the Seahawks have not done since the last time they were there, when they had, you know, an elite defense and an elite running, legendary running back. He needs to be able to believe that they can do all of these things. And I do think that there's a chance with this appointment that he, at very least, is sat somewhere, maybe still in Mexico. I don't know where he is right now, doing the things that Russell Wilson and the Sierra do. He may well be sat there thinking, yeah, I can buy into this. I can buy into it. Personally, I don't know whether it was his top choice or not. He may well have preferred someone like Doug Peterson, who's won a Super Bowl, who's been there, done that, got the T-shirt. But he said he didn't want to coach this year. It never really made much sense that he was going to coach, because he'd have been doing it for free. He's going to get paid by the Eagles, whatever happens. So I think this is probably about as excited as I could be about an offensive coordinator. And look, I said it, Robert. I thought when Shane Steichen's name was mentioned right off the bat, that he was just going to get the job. And if it wasn't going to be him, then I thought it was going to be an underwhelming yes man. So I'm happy to admit I'm wrong. I always am. I don't know why people think I've got this issue with not fronting up when I'm wrong. I'm happy to admit that I was wrong on that. I'm very pleasantly surprised. I want the Seahawks to win, believe it or not. I want the Seahawks to do things that we can all agree are good things, you know, and I think that this is one of those instances. So I'm very happy to be proven wrong. Now, I think the McVay factor is a big thing, one of the big positives for me on this, Robbie. Now, clearly, I would say there's probably two great offensive minds in the NFL who are head coaches. And one of them is Sean McVay, and one of them is Kyle Shanahan, both in the division. McVay has surrounded himself with good coaches. So Matt LaFleur didn't have the finest hour on Sunday, admittedly, but has done a very good job in Green Bay. He was in the exact same role as Waldron was with the Rams, and took the job in Tennessee to be their offensive coordinator because he wanted the opportunity to call plays. And this situation is very, very similar, in my opinion, Robbie, because I don't think anybody would have looked at the Titans offense and gone, wow, what an amazing opportunity. It's not like he was going to coach Trevor Lawrence or It's not like he was going to go and coach Justin Herbert by going to the Titans. So he took that job, took a risk, took an opportunity to be the play caller. And within a year, he was a head coach. Now, if in a year's time, Waldron is a head coach somewhere else, I don't think that's a bad thing at all, because it meant that the Seahawks had a fantastic year. I'd happily replace offensive coordinators every year if it meant that the guy was getting a head coach job, because that means he's done an amazing job and there's a chance that the Seahawks are winning games and getting to Super Bowls. So I've got no issue with that whatsoever. And I kind of think that Waldron is probably inspired a little bit by LaFleur and thinks that he can come to Seattle and he can put himself in contention to be a head coach down the line. Maybe he could even be the head coach in Seattle, because Pete Carroll is nearing the end. And it's an opportunity, if he doesn't go somewhere else, to maybe eventually take over from Pete Carroll. I think he's from Portland. So he's a Pacific Northwest guy. At least originally he's from Portland. He may fancy that job. He may fancy being the heir apparent there and working with someone like Russell Wilson. Back to McVay though. He's got Matt LaFleur. He knows a coach when he sees one. Wade Phillips, he's a 31-year-old head coach. At the age of 31, I was in no position to be a head coach of anything. I couldn't be the head coach of a day trip with my kids, let alone head coach of an NFL team. So he's gone in there and he brings in Wade Phillips, who vastly experienced, great person to have as a go-between and someone who can bounce ideas off and learn a little bit from there. They go to a Super Bowl together. When it's time to move on from Wade Phillips, doesn't stick with him forever, moves on, gets Staley, who's gone in and created the number one offense in the NFL in 2020. He's gone off now to go and coach the Chargers. You know, there's Zach Taylor as well, who's not quite had the same level of success in Cincinnati. I'm kind of willing to give him the benefit of the doubt, given that it's a bit of a dumpster fire in Cincinnati and always probably will be. And I think Marvin Lewis, I can't believe Marvin Lewis hasn't got more of a look for a job this year, by the way, given the way that he propped up the Bengals for year after year after year after year. He never won a playoff game, but the fact they're in the playoffs is incredible with hindsight. So that's a completely different topic. But, McVay has got a track record there, Robbie, of being around good people. He's obviously a smart guy. I like Sean McVay. I'm a little bit jealous, actually, that the Rams get to have him. So the fact that the Seahawks have tapped into that and can not only maybe bring some of his ideas and his creativity and his scheme to Seattle, well, it also, I find it a little bit reassuring that, a bit like Kyle Shanahan, I don't think McVay surrounds himself with mugs. And I think the Seahawks have probably got a good guy as a consequence.
Yeah, I mean, you said it right there, right? I mean, he brings creativity. They're gonna scheme to get guys open. You know, they're creative in the running game. You know, they do a good job of doing misdirections and all sorts of different things like that. You know, they run more kind of like a tempo, up-tempo offense. It's kind of what Russ wanted too. So, you know, I really like this hire. And they're right, you know, bringing someone in from McVay's, you know, offense, he can only, I think it can only benefit us going forward. And not only that, I mean, he could also give us some tips on how we can help stop the Rams sometimes. So, I mean, that's going to be great. So yeah, I think there's a lot of wins out of this. And I think this is just a good stepping stone for us going in the right direction. And I'm really, really excited about it. I'm excited to see Russ get a few more opportunities to do some like bootlegs and get out of the pocket, because I think that's where he really shines. And I think it's gonna be good for us all around. And I see a lot of people talking already about like what this could do for like Freddie Swain or someone like that, like they scheme to get these kind of guys open and really help their careers. Because you talk about I was listening to 710 this morning, and they were talking about Robert Woods and how he was basically cut by the Bills and people didn't really think much of him, and now all of a sudden he's one of the top wide receivers. And Cooper Kupp was the third round, definitely talented, but third rounder and stuff. So they're bringing in these guys who they're getting them open. And you imagine what he can do with someone like Lockett and DK, and then you add a Freddie Swain, or maybe even scheme for David Moore, who knows, like it just different. So I'm just really excited about the opportunity for the Seahawks going forward. And it's just an excellent hire.
I would have loved to have heard the phone call. I'm guessing it was a phone call between McVay and Waldron when he says, just so you know, I'm going to the Seahawks. Because as you mentioned there, I'm not saying that for a second that that McVay will have started cursing down the line or slammed the phone down. But from an intel point of view, yeah, I mean, he's swapping teams. I always kind of feel a little bit like I because the game is, it's a very complex game to us mere mortals on the outside. I think everybody who is sort of living and breathing, you know, football on a professional level, I think they kind of know it, what everybody does, and they kind of have an angle on every scheme. And look, it doesn't mean you can stop it, or that they won't have new ideas. But I always kind of wonder a little bit whether there's that much information to be gleaned when a coach or a player switches teams. But every little helps. And the Seahawks have had a rough time with McVay and their approach. So tapping into that is certainly beneficial. And also, you know, the Seahawks have been pretty predictable on offense. I mean, they were very predictable in the wild card game. So if this helps them not be predictable anymore, that isn't going to benefit the Rams either, which would also piss McVay off. So I'd love to know what his thoughts were when he found the news, although I'm sure as a stand-up guy, he would have congratulated Shane Waldron and wished him the best, even though they are now going to be competitors. I think on the whole scheme thing, Robbie, and like you, I've seen a lot of what people are saying, and you know, I've seen arguments about is Freddie Swain the next Robert Woods, and I've seen are they now suddenly going to, you know, abandon all plans with their O-line that they've incorporated over the years and suddenly go for lighter, quicker offensive linemen to move the pocket, and this guy doesn't work in the McVay scheme and this guy does. And I kind of think I would recommend that everybody just pumps the brakes on that, because I don't think Shane Waldron is coming to Seattle to just run a mirror image of what is going on in LA. What they're going to probably do, in my opinion, is steal some of those ideas and some of those concepts and add it to what is already in Seattle. So I don't think we're going to see a sea change. I mean, personally, I think it would be the stupidest thing the Seahawks could do to get rid of Mike Solari and suddenly try and find another offensive line coach somewhere who does a completely different scheme. I mean, unless Waldron's got his own guy that he's desperate and adamant to bring in, and that was part of the deal, I don't think there'd be any benefit from getting rid of Solari, who I think has done a really good job. And look, there's been times where the line's not been very good in Solari's period in Seattle, but it's a major improvement based on what it was before. And we also have to remember that the Seahawks have not invested that much in their offensive line over the last few years. And they do have some suspect players, and they've had some injuries as well, which have probably contributed more than, I would say, Mike Solari's ability to coach an O-line. So I don't think abandoning that would be a good idea. Plus, you've also invested in Damian Lewis, who's one of your best, you know, players in the rookie class last year. Are you suddenly going to get rid of him because he's a big mauler rather than a quicker, more nimble, agile blocker? Are you going to get rid of Brandon Shell, who by all means had a decent first season in Seattle? Are you going to get rid of Dwayne Brown? I mean, I don't think that you're going to do any of those things. I think you can run a play action heavy, run focused offense, which, let's be honest, is what McVay runs, with a bit of misdirection and a bit more game planning. That's the thing. It's the, okay, who are we playing this week? Okay, you're playing the Bills. What do the Bills do well? They do this well. What do they not do well? They don't do this well. Right, okay, here's the game plan based on that, rather than just, we're going to rock up there. We're going to do what we do because we're the Seahawks, and you know, we're going to throw a screen pass that's so obvious that the guy was practically celebrating as he was catching the football for the pick six. You know, it's, you know, that has to go, and there has to be more game planning now. And that's, you know, I'm hoping that is what they're going to get, because McVay is a master game planner. And you know, and you could see, you know, did they have some crappy results in 2020? Yeah, they lost to the Jets, but they also went and smacked the Tampa Bay Buccaneers in Tampa, and they're now in the Super Bowl. So, you know, I think that this is hopefully good news in terms of their ability to game plan. I don't personally think we're going to see massive changes to the scheme there, Robbie. I just think we'll see some new concepts and a bit more variety, a bit more game-to-game planning. And that, for me, is all I ever wanted. I didn't want any more than that. I don't need Sean McVay's entire offense. We just need to see a bit more than we saw in the past.
Yeah, I mean, and then third downs, obviously, I'd like to see, you know, how he's going to, you know, what his plans are for a third and four and such. And I think he'll have a better idea of what to do and how to get guys open for that. And, you know, like I said, getting Russ out of the pocket and those kind of things will be, I'd be really, really big and beneficial for us. And you're right about the O-line. And I don't see any reason why that our O-line, even though they're big, you know, maulers. They can't run that scheme or play that way. I think, you know, they're conditioned to do that. And I think they'll be just fine running a little bit more than they are now. You know, Damian Lewis or whoever. I mean, we got some holes that we're going to need to fill, right? When you figure out what we're doing at center and left guard. But you're right, we're not getting rid of Dwayne Brown. But I mean, you know, we still have to plan for what's going to happen after Dwayne Brown. I mean, he's got maybe a couple of years left, if that. So, you know, there's ideas of maybe having someone come in that might be a little bit lighter, that is a little bit quicker to groom in the backfield. But for right now, nothing's going to change on the O-line. They're going to keep that the same, except for, you know, we'll see what they do at center and left guard. And, you know, I really think that the pieces that we have could fit well in the scheme anyway. So yeah, you're right. We're not going to see, I don't think a ton of change, but it'll be, you know, I think there's going to be a lot more creativity and a little more up-tempo. And I think this is going to really, really work out for us.
Tempo, huge. I mean, just how much better were the Seahawks when they played with tempo in 2020? And we talked about it, Robbie, after some of the games, like, where was the tempo? And you know, I think, well, you know, why would you ever get away from that? Because they were so much better when they played quick and played with tempo. And you can mix tempos. You don't have to be all out, you know, fifth gear, foot to the pedal, every single drive. It was just that they would mix their tempos a little bit. And when they came out quicker, it seemed to work. And they kind of just went away from that at the end, which didn't really make any sense to me. I think this is, to me, Robbie, when I woke up and I saw the news, to me, this is probably the most exciting piece of breaking news the Seahawks have had probably since the Jadeveon Clowney trade. Because when they traded for Clowney, it was a huge name on a, you know, for a bargain, felt like at the time, third round pick, addressing a huge need right before the season. And everybody overwhelmingly said, great move. You know, that's it. And I think with some other trades, you know, I think the Jamal Adams trade, there's kind of like, what did they overpay? And it was, you know, especially the position and stuff like that. I think there was a lot more of a difference of opinion on that. So this to me is the most exciting news probably since the Clowney trade. Universal approval. I've not seen anybody going, oh, I'd gone for somebody else. I think universally it's got a seal of approval. I noticed that a lot of people were pining for Ken Dorsey, the Buffalo quarterbacks coach, Robbie, and I never really understood that. You know, because, and I think Jake Heaps put a poll up and he was like, who would you rather have, Ken Dorsey or Shane Waldron or somebody else? I can't remember the names that were on the list. And I was like, no, I replied to him and said, Waldron, of the list that you've got, because in LA, they've had to scheme around the fact that Jared Goff is not the best quarterback. They've had to scheme around the fact that they've lost Todd Gurley and he was such a huge deal for them. They've had to scheme around the fact they haven't got the most amazing offensive line, but it does a job for them. And I would even argue that players like Cooper Kupp and Robert Woods are good players, Robbie. But they're not DK Metcalf, and they're not, you know, Jefferson, and they're not Diggs, and they're not Julio. You know, they're just good players. And they've kind of had to scheme around what they've got and work with what they've got and come up with something that fits. And I like that. That's what Seattle needs. It needs someone who's going to go, we have DK Metcalf. How do we get the best out of it? We have Russell Wilson. How are you going to get the best out of it? What works to bring the best out of these really talented players? That's what the Seahawks really, really need. Now, in fairness to Ken Dorsey, who may be a great coach. I mean, who knows? If he gets the Miami gig now, we'll get a chance to see. But to me, he was the quarterback's coach in Buffalo. And yeah, Buffalo had a really good season. But how much of that was just down to the fact that Josh Allen is a freak of nature? And yet, you have to give the quarterback coach credit for helping Josh Allen realize his potential this year. But at the same time, wasn't that just a case of at least 3 years in the league? And he's kind of just worked things out, and the Seahawks don't need an offensive coordinator to help Russell Wilson work things out. They need an offensive coordinator who can scheme better and get the best out of what they've got across the board. So I was always much more in favor of Waldron than Dorsey, Robbie. And I think I may have been, I don't think there's anybody really other than if they'd have got someone from the Shanahan system, or as I mentioned, Peterson, that would have matched how pleased I was to see this news. It was a relief, but also there was a lot of excitement.
Yeah, I think on the Doug Peterson thing, like if he would have been hired, I think it would have been, for me, I would have been super excited, but I also would have realized it would probably be just a 1 year thing and he's probably off getting a head coaching job somewhere else next year. And so, you know, and that could still be possible with Waldron. You never know. But I mean, yeah, I think you're right. I mean, this is probably the most excited I've been about, you know, a coordinator for a while. So I mean, it's an opportunity that you look at and just go, hey, man, like this actually has something that could be real with it. And like you were saying, like, you know, Cooper Kupp and Robert Woods are good players, but they're not DK Metcalf. They're not Tyler Lockett. I mean, these guys are going to, you know, I think going to really benefit from this kind of offense as well. And I start looking at other players on our roster, not just, you know, the wide receivers, but you start looking at how they use tight ends and, you know, what can they use with Will Disley and you know, Colby Parkinson. And, you know, you start looking at guys like maybe like, maybe this could be a way that they could utilize Rashad Penny better or whatever and see how, you know, maybe use his skill set a little better. Cause we know that Penny can play. He just hasn't been able to prove it like or play very much and seems to get hurt a lot. And, you know, I know he only had 1 year at San Diego State, but we've seen flashes. And if we can see him continue some of those big play flashes and maybe they can get him in position to do that, that'd be great. But and how they're going to use the running back position, I just like you start looking at all these other position groups and how they're going to be affected. And for me, I think tight end is going to be one of the big ones that's really going to be you know, beneficial for us as well. And I think it'll be nice to see us use the tight ends a lot more than we have been in the past.
Absolutely agree. I mean, one of the more frustrating things of the 2020 season, actually, Robbie, that they spent $10 million on two tight ends, drafted another one in round four, still had Will Disley, at times had five tight ends on the roster, and never worked out a way to get a sausage out of them, really. I mean, there was just absolutely nothing from the tight ends. You know, the occasional catch here or there, the odd TD every now and again. And, if you're going to have a tight end on the roster, Robbie, you've got to find a way to use them. The NFL uses tight ends, dynamic tight ends in creative ways these days. Seahawks have got to get on board with that. They've got to join the party. And, you know, I wouldn't be against them, but we'll talk a little bit about what happens next, I think, at the end of the podcast. But there are tight ends in this draft, you know, Freiermuth at Penn State, who I'd love to see in Seattle. I mean, I don't think it's going to happen, but I'd love to see him because I think he's got a little bit of a Gronk to him. And, you know, you've got guys like Brevin Jordan as well, Yeboa at Ole Miss. That, you know, you can use his mismatch weapons. And I kind of look at these guys and I think, oh, they're going to look so good on somebody else's offense because the Seahawks don't use the tight ends like that. You know, when's the last time the Seahawks had a really, I mean, even Jimmy Graham, they tried to turn him into a complete tight end. You know, when are they going to get that guy who can be like a 700, 800 yard tight end who scares the crap out of opponents? You know, it'd be great if Waldron can take the Seahawks to that level as well. So here's hoping on that. I want to read.
If you look at the Rams, you know, they got Tyler Higbee and Gerald Everett. I mean, those guys aren't, in my opinion, like world beaters. They had really good seasons, and I think Will Disley and Colby Parkinson could add or be even more valuable than those two guys.
Yeah, I'd agree. I certainly hope Parkinson had got. I mean, we talked about this before, Robbie. Parkinson was being graded as a potential first round pick. Before things went badly wrong for KJ Costello. And, you know, I know that he had that one good game for Mississippi State at the start of the season and everyone was saying, first round pick. And I was like, no. We've seen this one before at Stanford. He's not good enough. And Parkinson's stock took a nosedive. I think mainly as a consequence of the messy quarterback situation and transitioning to Davis Mills. So hopefully he can deliver on that next year and can be a big part because they have to save money somewhere. And, you know, Colby Parkinson and Will Disley being the guys could be where they do it. But as I mentioned, there's some good guys in the draft as well. So here's what McVay is quoted as saying about Waldron. And then after that, I want to put a couple of points to you, Robbie, which, I don't want to take the shine off the moment, but I want to put them to you and see what you think. So this is what McVay says. He's a phenomenal coach. He's a great communicator. He's got a rare ability to authentically and genuinely connect with not only coaches, but the players and be able to correct in a manner that doesn't make guys' guards come up. It's all about problem solving and doing it together. He's obviously done a phenomenal job, really mainly as our leader for our offense, not exclusively to just being a passing game coordinator. Asked if he was prepared to be a coordinator in the NFL, McVay offered a bittersweet stamp of approval. Absolutely. I'll be extremely disappointed selfishly if we lost him, but so happy if that's something that he felt like was next for him and his family. There's no doubt about it. He's a great coach and he's certainly ready if that's the next step that he decides he wants to take. So that's really nice to hear Sean McVay talking in those terms about this guy as well. There is one thing that I wanted to bring up. I can't remember if there's a couple of points here or just one. So I wanted to get your thoughts on this. Is there anything to be said for the fact that Staley, the defensive coordinator in LA, has taken over the Chargers' job? And one of the first things he did was request permission to speak to Kevin O'Connell, the offensive coordinator in LA, about being the offensive coordinator in LA still, but with the other LA team. And the Rams rejected that, even though he would have been the play caller with the Chargers. He isn't with the Rams. The Rams rejected that. So Staley had to look elsewhere. I never saw Waldron's name linked to that Chargers job. Now, I don't know why. Maybe Brandon Staley and Shane Waldron just don't get on. It's possible. Maybe they weren't particularly close. I mean, it's plausible, isn't it? I mean, it's not beyond the realms of possibility, and it wouldn't be a review of his coaching if that was the case. But I just found it a little strange, Robbie, that his name, unless I'm missing something, was never linked with that job, and they ended up going after Joe Lombardi. And I think that the other thing I was going to mention was, is there any concern at all that I was flicking through the videos on, I was trying to find an interview with Shane Waldron, actually. I couldn't find one on YouTube. What I could find was a Bengals fan saying, this guy's interviewed for the Bengals head coaching job. I want him. He's the next Sean McVay. Get him to Cincinnati. We need Shane Waldron. And they appointed Zach Taylor instead. Now, Zach Taylor had connections to Cincinnati, and knowing the Bengals, that probably was what sealed the deal. So I'm not sure it's that concerning. But I'm just saying, you know, there's been a couple of jobs there where he's either interviewed for a head coaching job and not got it, and then there's this, you know, not seeming not even getting a look in the Chargers job, where you would think that would be a fairly straightforward connection.
No, I'm not super worried about that. I mean, there could be too many. There's too many factors that could play into that. I mean, they may have requested information to talk to him. He may have said he didn't even want that job. You know, there could have been something like, some sort of contractual agreement that they couldn't go after him. Or I don't know. There could be all sorts of different reasons why. And you're right. They maybe just didn't get along very well, so they just decided not to go that route. Or, you know, maybe he didn't want to, you know, pull too many guys from McVay's offense or whatever. I'm not really sure. There could be all sorts of different things. Not something I'm worried about, though. Not at all.
So Waldron is going to be the offensive coordinator. I wanted to sort of end, Robbie, reflecting on what is next for the Seahawks, because this was the first big domino to fall in the offseason, offensive coordinator being appointed. But now the Senior Bowl is ongoing. And, I have to admit, it is killing me watching the videos that I'm seeing posted. Because 1 minute it's Eskridge is destroying somebody in a route and making a difficult catch. And then, you know, here's a whole bunch of offensive linemen who are showing up. And, oh, look, here's a 36-inch armed Florida State pass rusher who runs a 4-2 short shuttle. And, oh, look, he's just destroyed someone in a 1v1 rep. And I'm thinking, oh, my God, the Seahawks have only got 3 or 4 picks in this draft. And, you know, all this talk about, well, there's no combine and the virtual meeting. So, you know, pass on this draft because you don't have the information. It was totally justified to make a huge trade. No, now that we're actually here, no, you can easily see who's a good player, who's not a good player. You know, if me in Rotherham, England, can watch film and go, that guy looks pretty good, then anybody can. So you don't need the combine. You don't need to meet these guys in person. You work around it. I mean, the whole league's not bailing on the draft. So for me, Robbie, when I look at a team that has got a starting center out of contract, a starting left guard out of contract, running back, cornerback, tight end, Sam linebacker, all starters all out of contract. Then a whole bunch of players like Benson Mayowas, who are on 1 year deals. Jacob Hollister was on a 1 year deal. There's other guys that are in that situation as well who are going to be out of contract. You've got people like Puna Ford, who's a restricted free agent, who is going to get, I'd imagine, a second round tender. So he's going to get what Jacob Hollister got this year. So you're talking $3.2 million, something like that. Not cheap. Yeah, not expensive, but not cheap, given that he was on an undrafted free agent contract. So you've got a lot to get done. And according to Over the Cap, they've got just over $100,000 in cap space right now, effective cap space, Robbie. So they've got nothing to spend. They've got four draft picks. I'm sat here thinking, the next big thing to drop is John Schneider doing whatever he's going to do to get more resource, whether that's creating cap space or getting draft picks. I'll tell you now, I don't think there's any way that the Seahawks are going into this draft with three or four draft picks. Absolutely no chance. And there's no way they're going to rely on trade, in my opinion. Could be wrong, my opinion, that they'll trade down from 56 in order to get more stock in rounds 5, 6, and 7 to fill out their board. John Schneider will be fully aware he's got to get back in this draft. He's got to get the Seahawks back into days 1 and 2 somehow. And I'm intrigued to see how they're going to do that, Robbie, because I think it's going to happen.
I mean, that's interesting. I don't know who, other than Jamal Adams, who do you trade to get back into that round? I mean,
that's the question, isn't it, though? What are they going to do? They've got to do something. I think that they are going to do something. And I'm intrigued to see what it is. And, you know, I'll talk about Jamal Adams in a second, but, you know, what do you think? What do you think? If you disagree, then tell me.
I just don't see it happening. I mean, I don't think they're going to trade Jamal Adams. I really don't. I just don't think it's going to happen. I know people are clamoring for it and think to get back into the first round and that kind of stuff. But I honestly, my opinion, I just don't think they're going to do it. I don't think they're going to do it. I just don't. And I think what's going to happen is they're going to stick with that second round pick. I think they will probably try to trade down a little bit to gain another pick or two. And I think you'll probably see most of your moves made on day 3 and we'll probably pick up another 3 or 4 round picks there to gain some guys. And that'll be it. I think we cashed in with a Jamal Adams, and that's how this year's going to be. And then, you know, we'll see how salary cap goes and what they're going to be at. And then, you know, we'd be playing the bottom of the barrel kind of free agent market and trying to fill holes there. And you never know. I mean, with the way the salary cap going to be, and, you know, other teams are going to be in the same boat. So, you know, just, you're going to see guys taking a lot less than they probably would have previously. So, yeah, I don't know. I just don't see a big trade happening. I mean, I could be wrong. I mean, I could, very well could be wrong, but I mean, you know, April's coming up pretty fast for the draft, and I just don't see anything. I mean, of course, we haven't heard anything about what's happening with Jamal Adams or any, you know, contract extension talks or anything like that. So, you know, I think there's still time for all that to happen, but in my opinion, I don't see it being a realistic option.
See, I would say the opposite. I think I can't see it not happening. Something. I'm not talking about Adams necessarily. I think Adams is the most likely, but I think they're gonna do something. Whether it's Bobby Wagner, whether it's Jamal Adams, I cannot imagine, Robbie. It's just, for me, there's no alternative, because otherwise how are you gonna replace your guys? I mean, you can't even at the moment pay Puna Ford his restricted free agent deal, because you have no money. You have $100,000. Now, people always go, well, you can extend Carlos Dunlap and lower his cap hit. Yeah, you can. You can lower his cap hit a bit, but unless you're giving him a 5-year deal at age 32, then his cap hit is going to be $2, $3, $4 million cheaper than it was. And then it'll be huge next year. So you're kind of pushing the problem into next year, which isn't a wise thing to do. You can't really lower a guy's cap hit that much when he's 32. If he was 26 and you didn't mind having him until he was 31, you can do it. You know, Frank Clark's cap hit and his second contract, which he signed with the Chiefs, was $6 million in year one. And then you backload it. When you're extending a guy by a year, you can't, what are you going to do? Pay him $30 million next year and $5 million this year? It doesn't make any sense. And then you look at other guys. So you could extend Tyler Lockett. I'd have no issue with that. But how much really are you going to save by extending Tyler Lockett? Because he's 29. He's getting into his late 20s. So you may be talking 3, 4-year extension, possibly. I'd say probably more likely 3 years on top of what he's already got. And he's not going to be taking a pay cut. Just had another 1,000-yard season. So again, if I was Tyler Lockett and I'm signing an extension, I'm not saying, yeah, do you know what? Lower my cap hit this year. unless you're going to make up for it down the line. And then again, do you really want to be paying Tyler Lockett huge money in 2 years' time that you can't get out of? I'm not sure you want to get down that path. People say, well, Russell Wilson could do you a favor. Why should he? And at what point in the last 8 years has Russell Wilson shown that he's remotely willing to give you a discount? I think he sort of, I think when they got Sheldon Richardson, he did something with his contract to enable them to get Sheldon Richardson, which is fine. I'm sure if you went to Russell Wilson right now and said, Russell, we need a pass rusher. Will you help us out? He'd probably go, yeah. If you go, Russell Wilson, we've only got $100,000 to spend this year. Could you maybe give us $10 million? He's going to go, well, no. And that's just not realistic. So, and again, if you extend Bobby Wagner's contract, what's he going to do? I think you've kind of just got to accept that you can talk about extensions and restructures. If you want to go down that road, you're going to find yourself in real trouble in a year or two. You'll be back where you were in 2017, having needing a major reset and having to go through years with no stock, no resources and nothing. And you don't want to get in that position. So I think something has to give. I don't know what it is. I'm not going to say definitively, I think they're going to trade Jamal Adams. I think they should, but I don't think they necessarily will. But they've also drafted a linebacker in the first round whose best position is inside linebacker. And I'm thinking, well, maybe you do have to just say to Bobby Wagner, we're going to move you. I don't know what you could get for him, a third round pick. I don't know. But you make a saving and you build your team. They're going to have to do something. And just, I'll let you back in a sec, Robbie. I personally think it has to be Adams, because I just don't see any sensible, plausible reason whatsoever to be paying Jamal Adams $18 to $20 million a year. That, to me, would be a complete and utter waste of money. And if I'm John Schneider and Pete Carroll, and I'm actually feeling invigorated, Robbie, by the fact that they've got Shane Waldron as their offensive coordinator, because to me, it shows that they're ready to get real. They're going to make the big calls. They're going to do what needs to be done. And you have to look at this and go, what is best for this team for the next 2 or 3 years? Is it having Jamal Adams and the 56th pick? Or is it having $20 million to spend for the next 3 years, $9 million extra to spend this year, and having not just 56, but potentially a first-round pick and a third-round pick if they get that back? You're talking about 5 or 6 players here, Robbie. You're talking about being able to say, all right, you don't have Jamal Adams, but you go and get Keanu Neal. On PFF projecting him to be on $5 million for next year. Malik Hooker's projection is $2 million. $2 million for Malik Hooker, and you move Quandre Diggs to strong safety. Is that not an appeal? Isn't that not more appealing? And then you could get Richard Sherman, and you could maybe get Brandon Scherf. Or you could just blow it all on Leonard Williams and have your version of Aaron Donald at the center. Or you could get Lindley, the center at Green Bay. Or you could, you know, just do what they've done and plug in depth players across and have some draft picks to go and spend in a fantastic draft class for interior offensive linemen. And there's a great running back called Javonte Williams, who, I don't know if you've noticed, Robbie, but more and more people are starting to project him as a top 50 pick. So he ain't going to be, he's not going to be sat there in 56. He's not going to be sat there in round 4 for you. He's going to go early. So I'm looking at this draft class. I'm seeing guys that I know full well John Schneider's looking at and going, oh my God, I would love to draft him. And I know he's looking at this free agency market and going, how am I going to fill that hole? How am I going to fill that hole? How am I going to fill that hole? I think they took a chance on Jamal Adams. And I think there's nothing wrong with that. But it's time to move on.
So a couple of things. First, you know, I just don't think you're going to get a third round pick for Bobby. I just don't. I think 31-year-old middle linebacker with the amount of money he's making, I just don't think see a team that thinks we are a middle linebacker away from being a Super Bowl champion. And I just don't see that happening. Plus, I don't think they want to get rid of Bobby. I think they love his leadership and all that. So I don't see it being Bobby. And here's the thing about Jamal Adams. He still has one more year. So they could be rolling the dice and being like, yeah, but we're not the Jets. So you can't say, you know, we helped you generate 9.5 sacks. We helped you become, and we will make you money. It's just not going to be this year. Or they say, okay, we're going to give you a new contract. We're going to extend on what you currently have. You're going to make what you made this year, but next year we're going to pay you the 18, 19 million or whatever it is that he's asking, with maybe a higher, you know, signing bonus or something. So I see where you're going. And I'm not saying I disagree completely. I just don't think that's what they're going to do. I would be happy to be wrong, because I think you're right. I mean, we do need to kind of, I wouldn't say blow it up, but I think there's some things that need to be done. And I would love to get younger and faster and get some more guys in. But I mean, Jamal's pretty young. The problem is the injury history, and he just plays out of position. From what we actually need him to do. You know, I mean, yeah, you're right. We could, you know, trade him and get some picks and, you know, go get a, but we still, if we do trade him, we're going to be right back in the same boat where we need pass rushers and we need a way to generate a pass rush. And, you know, I know that, you know, Dunlap is, you know, helped us a lot in that aspect, but you need more than that, right? I mean, it's not like Dunlap came in and gave you 10 sacks in the last six games or whatever. So it's going to be different.
Let's just get real with Jamal Adams for a second here. So one way or another, he's gonna get $9 million this year. The extension, if he gets it, won't kick until next year. So the money's not gonna come into play until next year. So it's gonna be $9 million, whatever happens this year. In terms of whether or not, you know, it's more about the future for that. It's looking ahead and sort of seeing, you know, are you better off having him taking up such a huge chunk of your salary cap from 2022 onwards? Than having him now. I don't think that if you say to him, we're going to wait and pay you, that he's going to play this year. I think he's going to hold out, and it's going to create a huge mess of a situation. I think you've got to make a call either way. Either you're paying him, you're committing to him, you're saying he is a core player that we have to absolutely have for the long term, or you're trading him. In my opinion, that's what it was for the Jets last year. It is what for the Seahawks this year. In terms of the pass rush, this is a sneaky issue, Robbie, because we're talking a lot of fans talking about offensive line and stuff like that. The pass rush to me is still not completely sorted. Carlos Dunlap's going to be a year older. Benson Mayo is out of contract. Rasheem Green, LJ Collier, they just don't offer enough as pass rushers. They just don't. That's not to say that they were truly awful. Their PFF grades weren't great, but they weren't awful. But they're not starters. They're not people that you can hang. They're depth players. And who knows what's going to happen with Darrell Taylor, and who knows who they're going to get the pass rush from. Personally, none of that is a reason for retaining Jamal Adams and saying that you need him for your pass rush, because this is the reality with Jamal Adams. On average, he blitzed, officially now, done the numbers, just over 8 times a game for the season in 2020. And he got home 0.8 times per game. So 0.8 sacks per game for those 8 blitzes, over 8 blitzes per game. So what does that tell you? It tells you that 7 out of 8 times, he doesn't get to the quarterback. That's 7 out of 8 times. What happened in those plays? Potentially the quarterback diagnosed the blitz and took advantage. And the problem for the Seahawks, Robbie, is that they telegraph a Jamal Adams blitz. So in a 3-4 scheme, 3-4 scheme, like the Ravens or the Jets, the Todd Bowles, the Greg Williams, the New England teams, you have 4 linebackers. Your edge rushers can drop. Your middle linebackers can drop. So what you can do is you can put a linebacker right in the A gap and then have him drop out and have Jamal Adams blitz from the edge. You can have your outside linebackers just do a bait and everyone else could drop and stay in coverage. Or you can mix and match. The whole point of like the Greg Williams and the Todd Bowles defense is that you never know where the pressure is going to come from. It could be here 1 minute, here the next. In Seattle, it ain't that. In Seattle, what it is, Jamal Adams has moved up to the line of scrimmage right before the snap. He's going on a blitz. And that's what it is every single time. And he's not beating anybody. He's not beating a left tackle. He's not beating a right tackle. He's not beating a tight end most of the time. What they do is they put, and Hugh Millen broke this down, and I put the clip on the blog. They put Bobby Wagner in the A-gap, and they say, we're going to blitz Bobby Wagner. So they shift the protection, and it creates the free running lane for Jamal Adams, and he runs straight to the quarterback. Now, I am telling you, if you give Keanu Neal those same opportunities next year, he will break the sack record for the NFL for defensive backs. Most defensive backs put in that situation will do. Jamal Adams is a really good player. He has a skill set which is perfectly designed for those kind of situations. But let's be real about what they're doing. They're manufacturing situations for Jamal Adams because they spent so much to get him and they have to justify it. Okay? It's not that he just is this. If they'd have traded for Joey Bosa and he had 12 sacks, Joey Bosa will be creating those sacks and you could be playing base defense. With Jamal Adams, they're having to put him in situations in order to get the production to succeed because they've invested in him. Now, that is a completely different situation. Now, I think the onus is on the Seahawks to find a way to get back to what they were doing in 2018, which is blitzing 18% of the time and had a better sack percentage. And that means a rushing with four and being able to play your defensive scheme. That, we see it. You know, what did the Niners do last year? They can rush. Okay, you can't put five first-round picks on Seattle's defensive line, but you can create a four-man rush. And that's what they've got to do. It needs to be one of the tasks moving forward. They've got to draft better. They've got to find guys who aren't going to cost an arm and a leg, who can come in and be a great pass rush rotation to enable the Seahawks to do what they need to do. So for me, the pass rushing thing is neither here nor there. And I just don't think the investment is warranted. I just don't. I mean, for me, he's a luxury. He's a nice player that if they'd have drafted him in the first round, you could, without a shadow of a doubt, love and praise and enjoy everything that he's about. But he costs the same as a franchise quarterback in a trade. He costs as much as the best cornerback in the league. He costs as much as an elite left tackle, Robbie, or an amazing pass rusher. He costs more than Khalil Mack. It was too much. And on top of a huge salary, on top of the picks that you've already spent, it's not value for money or value for draft stock. And I've said this before, if you want to play the kind of football the Seahawks want to play, you better be good in the trenches, O-line, D-line. The Seahawks aren't good in the trenches because all of their resources are at the safety position and linebacker. $25 million spent on Bobby Wagner and KJ Ryan last year and a first-round pick on Jordan Brooks, and they traded up in round three for Cody Barton the year before. They spent two first-round picks, a third, and Bradley McDougal to get Jamal Adams after spending a second-round pick on Marquise Blair and spending a fifth-round pick on Quandre Diggs and taking on his Detroit salary for his second contract. That is too much resource into linebacker and safety and not enough resource into the O-line and D-line. And that's where they need to be focusing now. They need to get some more draft picks and they need to draft D-line, O-line, and they need to make the strength of this team the trenches. And if they have to go and spend money on a Scherf or a Tooney or a Lindley or an Alex Mack to improve their offensive line, go and do it. Because you have to face Aaron Donald twice a year. He ended your season playing half a football game in the wild card.
With what money, though? With what money? Because we just sat here. We just sat here. And so what are you going to do? So how you create that money to it? So like, how are you going to create that money then? You just said we were going to struggle to sign free agents, even our own guys. We had $100,000. I mean, how are we going to create it? This is what we just talked about. So I'm curious how you think we are going to create it other than like, let me ask you a question. So you think trading Jamal Adams and Bobby Wagner, that's how you're going to create the money to go with these other guys, or how are you going to create it?
Yes, that's what I think that they should consider doing.
Okay.
Because I just think it's too much resource. And look, Bobby Wagner's a Seahawks legend. I don't want to see Bobby Wagner go. Bobby Wagner's not worth $18 million a year. I'm sorry, he's not.
And, I agree with that.
And it's none of us want to see Bobby Wagner leave. If Bobby Wagner's contract was $11 million a year or $12 million, or I don't know, I can't remember what the top contracts are, Robbie. I think the main contracts, you know, the guy in Houston, for example, I think he was on about $14 million. You know, even that seems a little rich to me. He's not providing $18 million worth of impact. He's just a really good, solid inside linebacker. And if you can't reduce his cap hit significantly, then I think you have to say, is there a team out there? The Jets might be an example who are sort of using the Seahawks scheme and want to try and get a culture going and want somebody who can come in and lead a defense that is starting over and a franchise that's starting over. Maybe they chuck a third round pick for him. I don't know. Dwayne Brown was a second and a third, and he was older than Bobby Wagner. So I don't know what trade value is.
But he's a premium position, right?
Left tackle. Yeah, right. Position. True, very true. I just don't know what Bobby Wagner's value is. I mean, like, who would have thought Mohamed Sanu would cost a second round pick a year ago? I mean, the trade value is all over the place. So it's a player's worth what a player's worth to a team. So he may be more valuable to like the Jets, for example, than he would be, you know, the Niners have got great linebackers. You know, I just don't know. And I can only repeat what I said, Robbie. You know, for me, I want the resource to go in the areas where I think that will help this team have the best success. I don't think you can be sentimental about this. I don't think you can say, oh, Bobby, great player, love you, we'll always love you, you're a legend, therefore we've got to have you forever. And, oh, you've traded all this for Jamal Adams, therefore we have to have him forever as well. No, it's okay to go, actually, what is going to help the Seahawks win? A great O-line and a great D-line, in my opinion, with DK Metcalf and Russell Wilson and Tyler Lockett and maybe another weapon. That is the key to success. And I'm willing to take a chance that Jordan Brooks can replace Bobby Wagner. I'm willing to take a chance that Keanu Neal or Malik Hooker can replace Jamal Adams, or even Marquise Blair or Ugo Amadi can do that. I will take that chance. If the Seahawks suck at safety next year in linebacker, by all means, come on, if they do what I'm saying here, and tell me what a complete fool I am for projecting what a stupid, such a stupid idea. I will take that crow and eat it. I have no issue with that whatsoever. But just anybody out there who's listening to this, tell me how this doesn't at least warrant a conversation and a consideration. Take $18 million salary and $9 million salary, make your saving this year. Avoid paying $18 million to Bobby next year and that's $36 million saved next year, for crying out loud. You know, you could backload Brandon Scherf's contract to hell and back with that much money saved. You could pay him $4 million this year if you wanted to get him in Seattle, and pay him a heck load next year, because you will make so much saving. And if you're saying to me, what do I want to see against the Rams next year, Robbie? Either Jamal Adams and Bobby Wagner against that Rams defense, or Brandon Scherf and Coy Lindley kicking the crap out of Aaron Donald. I know what direction I'm gonna go there. I want to try something new. I want to see something different this year. I've seen what this version of the Seahawks can do. Let's try something with a great O-line and a great D-line.
Yeah, and again, I'm not trying to argue with you, and I agree. Like, I'm not saying that we need to keep Bobby forever just because he's a Seahawks legend. I mean, I do agree with you. I think trading him would be a very smart decision, and we did draft, you know, Jordan Brooks to play linebacker. I mean, you know, we could see a very different linebacker core this year should KJ not return and Bobby not be here, you know? I mean, you know, but those are other positions now that you have to fill, right? Okay, so let's say you slide Jordan Brooks into that middle linebacker slot. You still have to fill that weak side and strong side linebacker spot now, because you don't have the money, or you don't have the players to do so. It's not like you just go generate those players. And I don't know, maybe you do give Cody Barton a chance to start, but I mean, we've seen him play, and I don't think neither of us would agree that he's where we want our linebacker core to be. But I mean, you're going to create other holes by doing this. And yeah, having the resources and the money, you know, spent on the offensive defensive line would be great. I just, for me, what I'm saying is I feel like the way that the Seahawks run their organization, and I just don't feel like they're going to admit the mistake of the Jamal Adams trade. It was too much. We gave up too much for him. I agree with that. I'm having a hard time picturing them trading him now, especially too. You have to keep in mind that he's coming off two different surgeries now. Like, I don't know if a team's really going to want to throw a first and a third to get him. I have a hard time imagining that being the case. And you know, it's just tough for me to imagine them doing that. And it's tough for me to imagine them actually trading Bobby. Like, it just doesn't seem like we're that kind of organization where we get rid of a guy unless it's really, really toxic. Then I just don't see it happening.
What I will say though, Robbie, is this is a team, in fairness, that has, once they've made a decision, they are willing to go back on it. So, and look, all these circumstances are different. Of course they are. But they moved on from Percy Harvin after a year. They didn't. They traded for Sheldon Richardson. They could have had him for $8 million a year. And they said, no, not a fit. And just walked away. They got nothing. They just wasted a second round pick on that guy. Who was the cut? Corey Williams, Carey Williams. Who was
Carey Williams? That guy was terrible.
$7 million on him, and they just cut him and ate it. So this is a team that, in fairness, when they've decided, look, we've took a punt. Clowney's another one, you know, Clowney, third round pick, you know, and they let him go. So when they've decided that it's time, you know, we just have to accept the situation and eat the decisions we've made and move on. There's others. Michael Bennett, they paid Michael Bennett and then they cut him a year later and absorbed millions and millions of dollars in dead hit just to get rid of him. So, you know, they've made moves that, you know, you would have thought, no, that's not going to happen. And then they have, in order to do what they think that they need to do. So I think there's a chance that I don't think Jamal Adams's trade value is 2 first round picks, a third and a player anymore. But I do think you will get a first rounder. He's at a good age still. And to some of these schemes, Miami, New England, Baltimore, New York Giants, Tampa Bay, if Todd Bowles stays there, which it looks like he is, he's a dream fit for them. And if you're talking about Miami, who are on the brink of the playoffs and have the number 3 overall pick as well, so they can spend that on another position. If they got like Devontae Smith, for example, and Jamal Adams, I'd be saying, if I was a Miami fan, I'd be saying, that's amazing. That's a really good use of the 2 picks. So I think that there's a potential for that, or at least a team in the 20s. And I think, you know, you maybe get a third round pick next year to fill the hole that you're losing a pick next year in 2022. And then from 18 or whatever, Robbie, you trade down a bit and you fill out your board a little bit more. That's what I would go for. And the final point is, I hope there's a way. I'd love to think there's a way of keeping Jamal Adams and Bobby Wagner and doing everything that they need to do. I really, really wish that I had that answer to that. And I've no doubt that people will, you know, this is the thing. People go, you can save $8 million on a restructure here and $6 million on a restructure here. And I'm thinking, where are you getting these numbers from? You know, how do you know what you're going to save on a restructure? That's up to the player as to what he's willing to do. And you never know. I just don't know what alternative you have. They don't have, like some teams, you know, when they're getting cap trouble, there's like a few players on that they can just cut and get rid of and like they save $10 million here and there. The Seahawks don't have any of those players unless they're going to get rid of Carlos Dunlap. Maybe they'll cut Carlos Dunlap. I don't know. And eat that one. But then, you know, we're talking about having holes that you need to fill then. That'd be a huge one. I mean, at least you've got a first round linebacker on the roster to replace Bobby Wagner potentially. And at least you've got a second round safety on the roster to replace Jamal Adams potentially. You don't have that. I mean, Darrell Taylor maybe, but who knows? I'm just writing him off until I see him on a football field, Robbie, in pads playing a game. So, you know, I just think you've got to be really honest about where you want your money to go. The cap, the league's in a weird place. You know, the pandemic has hammered the salary cap, where all of the teams are in a mess. I have no idea what's going to. Maybe the league will bail them out, Robbie, because if the league comes up with a solution here to, because some teams are $100 million over the cap and they're not going to be able to do, you know, sustain this. So if they come up with a plan to help the Saints and the Eagles and the Falcons, maybe that same plan helps the Seahawks and they can keep these guys. That's a distinct possibility. We'll be having a very different conversation if that happens. But if they don't come up with a way for the Seahawks to do it, and you've got to fight, it's a puzzle. The cap is a puzzle. How do you fit all the different pieces in there? And the overall picture has to be a championship roster. And for me, having a championship roster means great O-line, great D-line, rather than having $30, $40, $50, $60 million tied up in your linebacker and safety positions. Anyway, we've had a great conversation about it. It was good to get back on with you and talk this through. And the good news with Shane Waldron, and I'm glad we got to talk a bit about my favorite topic, which is the off-season as well, and draft picks and free agency and all of that. And we'll have a lot of coverage on that on Seahawks Draft Blog. The Senior Bowl is underway. We'll have a lot of coverage on that when we get a chance to actually review the tape, which is not going to be coming until next week, unfortunately. But we'll try and fill you in on everything that's happening there as we can. Head over to the blog now. I've got a few names to keep an eye on. There's a video on there with a piece I did with Cleveland.com this week talking about the draft and the Senior Bowl and loads of other things. So go and check that out as well. Many, many thanks to everybody who's been supporting the channel. Check out the draft interviews as well. I have to plug that. Jim Nagy's on there at the moment. Go and check that out. Give it a listen. Really interesting to hear from Jim again. And many thanks to him for giving up some of his precious time last week to talk. So go and have a listen to that. Check out the channel. Don't forget to hit like and subscribe as well. 20% of you who watch the videos are subscribers, which means there's 80% of you who are not subscribing, and that is not acceptable. So press the subscribe button and follow along for any, and you'll find out if there's any further podcasts coming up in the future. Until then, have a great day.